Okay, well, we'll do that while we get started because we've got timing. So, the Twitter hashtag for today, if you are on Twitter or you want to get on Twitter, is on the agenda. It's LibMeet's CEDP. So, if you want to be talking about what we're doing. And I'll just introduce the first presenter that we've got is Libby Gray from World Book. And so, she's going to speak to us for about 10 minutes about World Book. It may be an option for your school. So, she just wants to let you know about what they can offer.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thanks, Lisa, for having me. Okay, so I don't know how many of you, I know some here are subscribing to World Book Online already, but obviously World Book's been around for the last 90 years. It's been the biggest selling encyclopedia worldwide. And the reason being is that the articles are written for the reader. It's reliable, it's accurate, it's up to date. But what we obviously have now is the World Book Online. And so what we can obviously do is, you know, all students can access this product at school and also at home. So as you can see, we've got a really wide range of products and there is absolutely no way I can cover a portion of it in 10 minutes. So what I'm going to do is just really give you a summary and a brief kind of overview of the products. And what I've done is I've given everyone a catalogue and a trial as well. So you've actually got a month's trial in the catalogue. My details are all there. If you want information, pricing, all of those sorts of things, then you can get in contact, you know, with me, which is probably the easiest way. So what we've got, and I know it's difficult because obviously we've got primary schools here and high schools, and we actually have different products, obviously, for the different levels. So as you can see, we've got lots and lots of products, but what I'm going to just focus on is the basic products today, which is the ones over here, the World Book Web. So what we have is World Book Kids, World Book Student, and World Book Advanced. I'm going to sit over here so I'm not in the way. And what I'll do is really just show you the home page of each product. Lisa, when I'm getting close, just kind of tell me to hurry, because sometimes I do these presentations and, you know, I can sit here for an hour, so I will try not to. So I'll just really try and give a very quick overview. With schools, you actually, for your subscription, it's basically the basic pack is $1.12 per student per year. So if you've got, you know, 300 students, it's going to be under $400 per year. And if you're a primary school, that gives you access to kids, this product, and to student. For the high schools, it gives you student and advanced. So that's our basic pack. From there, we have classroom products. We have Early World of Learning, which is specifically for our kindies to kind of year two, year three. We have a science product. We have social studies. We have dramatic learning. So lots and lots of different products available. And with your trial, when you go on, you can actually trial all of the products. And there are online tutorials with the products as well, which go for about, depending on the product, about 8 to 12 minutes and is a fantastic way of just getting an overview of the product, because I really just can't, you know, do it today. So this is our kids site. And as you can see, first of all, it's bright, it's colourful, and the children using it love it. We get fantastic feedback on this product. Really, from when a student can start researching and typing into a computer, they can start using this kids' site. My daughter's in year four, so she's 10. She verges between kids because she loves it and it's, you know, fun. She then, for research, is kind of going on here and then going up to the next level. So really from about year four, but it depends on your students, year five, year six. And the nice thing is that you've got the different products, so you can actually give the opportunity to your students, depending on their level of reading and comprehension, that they can either go into kids or into student if they're up at that next level. So really, up the top, there's just lovely kind of high interest topics, often things that have been in the media. You have a search button here. Look, I'm just going to do a very quick search. I'm 7 years old and, you know, I love animals, so I'm just going to type in the word dog. What you can see is there's 106 articles, there's pictures and there's videos. The main article will be at the top, so you just click into that and then you can see the article. You can do things like print, save, you can email. This is also showing just here the translate this text and hear text read aloud. And this has been a really popular product, particularly in, you know, around Parramatta areas where there's 80, 90% students from non-English speaking background. What it does is translates into 30 different languages. It translates all of our products if you take on this extra. If you don't take on the product Discover, you will not see that. So it won't cause any confusion for the students. On the left, it has all of the contents if they want to jump straight into a certain subject. It has citation information, related websites with all of our articles. World Book have chosen other websites that they feel are also appropriate at the right level. So if they want more information, an encyclopedia has always been a first line of reference. It is not, we're never going to say it's going to give you everything, particularly at the high, you know, at the high school level, but it is a great way of getting a summary on a topic, and that's what it's always, you know, always been from our kind of print product, which I know a lot of you are still using in the libraries. And we actually just sold out of our 2012 and we have our 2013 on pre-pub, and I know some of you have already ordered that. So if anyone's interested, we have a great price on that. So with this, kids, basically, it's simple, it's bright, it's colourful, it's big font, lots of pictures, lots of videos. You have a built-in dictionary, so they just double-click on a word and you've got your dictionary meaning, once again, at a simple level. When you go up to the next level, the dictionary is obviously at the next level. So the article is really, it's interactive, and what you're wanting to do is teach children to research at a young age, but make it enjoyable and make it fun. And the children using this really do enjoy it. So you can scroll down, lots of pictures, videos on dog behaviour, husky dogs, training dogs. And then it goes down to the bottom. From there, if you've got a student that wants more information, they can jump straight to the next level. It teaches them how to cite the article, and then you've got on this one, for example, 8 external websites that they can then go to. If they go to an external website, this World Book interface, the kids, for example, will stay up the top. So what you're trying to do is teach children to research independently. But if they go to Google, one, particularly at this level, it's not at the right level for them. They get lost. They waste so much time. And I mean, I've seen it with my own children. So what you're doing here is offering, you know, a safe kind of alternative that's, you know, accurate and reliable and at the right level. You've got sections here just holding their hand to help them research. They've been told they need to do an assignment on, for example, a plant or an animal. They have no idea where to start. They jump into here and it narrows down the research. It goes, for example, into the classifications of animals. They can then jump straight into reptiles, brings up all the articles on reptiles. I don't have time to obviously show you all of that. Down the bottom here, you've got pictures. There's no copyright. There's lots and lots of pictures they can use for their assignments. They can print them off. Beautiful section here. This is my favourite area, called World of Animals, but I don't probably have time to show you. You can go in. There's over 150 different animals, including dinosaurs, which is a recent addition. Children can actually go in and bring up 2 different animals, and it brings up all the comparisons between them. From there, it has all the videos. We've just brought in animal noises as well, which the children are loving. And then it takes them to the article on the animal as well. So that's a really fun section for those students. Important people basically is finding biographies, helping them once again if you need to find inventors, explorers, Nobel Prize winners. We have science experiments at that nice simple level that they can do at home, at school. We have a dictionary, grammar, etc. Maps, we have interactive maps, Google Maps. We have full atlas on here so they can look up their rainfall population, those sorts of things. We've just introduced map outlines on PDF. You can go into any country, any state, and bring up the flag and the state. So for example, New South Wales, the actual New South Wales flag and the map outline are all just on one page. Print them off and give them to the students. You've got to compare places. They can go in and compare the different states of Australia or 2 different countries. So the schools were loving this with the Olympics, for example. They could actually compare the countries. And then you've got lots and lots of games and activities on here as well. So when they've finished their research, we have lots of interactive games. And you can see, I mean, there's even maths games, reading, grammar, there's puzzles, there's a match the flag, which was great with the Olympics as well. And then lots and lots of activities on here. And they're actually in the way children learn, the be it, the make it, the think it, the teach it. And they're activities that can be printed off for teachers and for parents at home, because don't forget they've got home access with this product. Now, that's the quickest I've ever run through kids. So what I'm going to do now is move to student. As you can see, there's all the products down the bottom here. Whatever you actually subscribe to will be the only products that actually show, so it won't cause any confusion for the students. Now, this student actually overlaps. So with primary schools, you get kids, which I showed you, and student. With high schools, you get student and advanced. So this student product is where I'll probably, you know, spend a little bit more time, because it's the one that everyone will actually be using. Once again, you've got a search button up the top. You can can also search by alphabetically or, you know, order by images. So if we just, I'm just going to put, look, a very general, say, Australia. But what you can actually do, by default it researches in student, you can also go into student and kids. So say you've got a year five, year six class, then, and you know that some, they're at, you know, they're at different levels. This gives them the opportunity to choose the level. Sorry, 2 minutes, okay. Right. So you basically go into the into the article. So you can see on the right over here, we've got the kids 300 articles. Over here, there's 1800 articles. What you also get in here is back in time articles, timeline builders, EBSCO articles. So there'll be up to 25 EBSCO articles as well. So for those high schools, on here as well. You've got biography centres, citation builder, you've got timelines. Behind the headlines, so this changes depending on what's happening within the news, and there's actually work plans and, you know, objectives and words to know on there. The whole product correlates to the New South Wales curriculum as well. And obviously I'm down to about 10 seconds, so I will just show advanced, which is the other product. The difference with advanced for the high schools is not so much the articles. When they research, it brings in your primary source documents. It also brings in an ebook centre here. We have over 5,500 ebooks, which is included with your subscription. The top nearly 800 are downloadable onto iPads, e-readers, etc. We're about to launch iPad apps, hopefully in the next month or two as well. So that will come with your subscription. It would just mean the homepage is a little bit different on the iPad. And for the younger ones, things like the games at the moment haven't been iPad compatible. We're converting everything to HTML5, hopefully in the next kind of month or so. Here you've also got world newspapers, so great for students studying different languages and for students obviously from other countries. They can look up all the world newspapers. For example, China, there's four different papers, three in, I think, Chinese, one in English. Teaching with documents, Reuters News, which changes all the time. So that is it in a very, very crazy 10 minutes. So
thanks.
Hopefully, sorry. That's very hard to do.
I
feel like I was on a marathon.
We're on it with you. Does anyone have any questions? I thought I might ask by a bit of a show of hands, who runs World Book in their primary schools? Because I know it's always nice to have a look around.
Yes.
Anyone run Encyclopedia Britannica in their primary schools? What about high school? Do you do World Book? Britannica? It's Mill and I. Okay. Just gives us a bit of an idea of where
I've got a full list, particularly in the public school system. For example, every primary school in Parramatta, the public schools are all using World Book Online. The selective high schools, Baulkham Hills, Normanhurst, Hornsby Girls are all using it. Most of the private schools. But I do have a list. There are huge amounts of primary schools just in this area that are actually using it. I do have a list here if anyone does want to know or to speak to anyone.
I've got a question about your app. Is it going to be like a full service app?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a real issue with EB, they don't have it.
Yeah, no, we're about to launch that. So what we've done, everything has been with Flash. So what we're doing is converting. We were told September, October. I've seen it. It's absolutely beautiful, the homepage. It's really visual, obviously, which is what you want on an iPad.
Yep.
And as I said, it will be part of the subscription. It's a fantastic product. And down in Victoria, for example, I did mention to a couple, the department actually gave every state high school in Victoria World Book Online last year. They chose that as their product of choice. They have just renewed their subscription. So the hundreds of schools down there are all using it very happily. It is, but obviously it's something you need to promote to your students. We have worksheets. We have a lot of, like, scavenger hunts. We have bookmarks. We have posters. We run webinars every term. As you can see, there's online tutorials down the bottom. There's a training guide as well down there that takes you in. We're working on, we correlate obviously to the New South Wales curriculum at the moment. Plans are in place for the Australian curriculum. That will be up and running early next year.
Okay.
So it's very much, you know, designed now with the Australian market. you know, in place. For primary schools, we have like an article, Gold Rushes in Australia, worksheets to go with it. About to bring out worksheets the next week or so for Antarctica as well. We had them for the Olympic Games. So we're really, you know, trying to keep those sorts of things happening as well.
I have a question.
Yes.
E-book centre spelled E-R, obviously American.
Yes.
Is that reflective of the content?
No, well, that's what I'm saying. It correlates to the New South Wales curriculum. It's with some of the spelling, and I have actually asked for that. They're looking at that to change it for the Australian market. But with the dictionary, for example, it is in the American and the British spelling. So that it's just literally that on the home page. But the Australian, I mean, you can go through and you, as I mean, look, the department in Victoria wouldn't have given it down there if they felt it wasn't, you know, going to work for them. And as I said, we're bringing out things like Gold Rushes in Australia. We've just put out a Bushfires in Australia article. So they're bringing out, they're updating all the Australian biographies at the moment. You can actually go through on the student and have a look at the whole Australian section, and it shows you every biography, every article, universities, newspapers, study guides, everything for the Australian market as well. And they're very conscious of that.
Another question. Sorry, can you just let us know again the prices?
It starts at $1.12 per student per year. So that's primary, that gives you kids and student, and for the high school student and advanced. So, and then we've got obviously all of these add-on products, which, you know, then are different pricings. But you can obviously have a look, particularly the early world of learning, which is down there on the left-hand side. And I'd say probably 90% of primary schools also add that on. For it's only between $170 and $186 for that as an add-on. And that gives storybooks, it gives readers, it has a first encyclopedia, videos, games. It's really bright, colourful, and just a lot of fun.
And are those component prices in the...
No, I do actually have some prices if anyone wants them. But it's just a little bit confusing because all the products are on there. But if I'm happy to either leave some or if does anyone want one, I can hand it or pass them round. What you can also do, what
I can
I've
email
done,
you if they have any
absolutely
queries.
Yep. You've got a trial site. Did everyone get this? Is the catalogue with the trial site. Sorry, it's only the black and white. I ran out of my colour ink. Down the bottom, my details are there. There's a trial site. So you just go to worldbookonline.com. It will ask you for an ID. It's ANZ School. The password is Cougar. That only started today. And that takes you through until December. So you've got a full month to actually... Neil, I can see your look there on the cougar. It's been animals this year. we've just gone off dolphin. I could just see you smirking there. So you've got the trial and we've got a wide range of print products in there as well. Lots of wonderful new print products for all levels on a wide range of topics too.
Oh, thank you very much.
So everything is there and my details are all there.
Terrific. So. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Hello everyone, my name's Bonnie Ma. I'm from Good Reading Magazine as well as Spineout Magazine. I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about Good Reading Magazine before we jump into Spineout. Has anybody heard of Good Reading Magazine? Yeah, does schools have subscriptions to yeah, yep. So Good Reading Magazine is a print as well as an online magazine. Sorry about the slide there. We've been in operation and publishing for the last 11 years. We have 120 back issues, and we've published over 5,000 independent reviews. So that's what Good Reading is all about. It's about books, everything about books, and about independent reviews that people read and do themselves. GR is predominantly used in senior schools as well as in municipal libraries. It's a wonderful resource for book buying. So, you know, people circle in the magazine all the time. I want this book, I want that book. And if you've got the online magazine, you can access it from within the school. So the whole school can access it at the same time and from home as well. So parents and students and everybody can sort of jump on and leisure read or actually use it as a resource. I was saying before that it's an online magazine. So this is wonderful for the schools. Again, it is something that the whole school can use. We have wonderful features that are sort of much more than what you get in the print. So we've got hyperlinks throughout. You can read first chapters. We've got really cool sort of interactive media, so you can hover your mouse over it and certain things will actually then pull up a call out box, so you can click on it and it'll actually give you more information as well. We've got maps, photo galleries, everything like that, so it's a very interactive online magazine. And because it's interactive and hyperlinked, it actually goes back to the Good Reading websites to, again, the first chapters. We've got lots of news, lots of extra information on the website. So news every day, author interviews, we've got a blog, we've got book club notes, we've got teacher's note, and that's something I want to highlight. So if you go to our website, you'll see actually a teacher's section. So there you'll find lots of teacher notes, lots of great information. And then we also have this one sort of feature that I want to highlight, and it's just for kids. So if you're in a bind, oh, I don't know what to get for the students, you can actually go to this page and actually find a book by age. So you basically click on it, they're 4 years and plus, you can then search, and then it'll show you all the appropriate books for that age group. So it's all the way up to 12 plus there. So that's a really good resource for teachers. You can actually get the kids to write to us. So if they have a review, they've read a book, they love it, it's fantastic, you can write to us and we'll actually consider it for publication in the magazine. So that's wonderful too. And that's on the website. So you don't actually have to subscribe to actually get that. You can go straight on the website and use that tool. So those are, and yep, so you can also go to the website and go to our e-newsletters. They're another great resource. We send them out monthly. We've got a few different ones that you can subscribe to. Great for schools and a little bit of extra information besides what you'll find in the magazine. And you can also find us on Facebook and Twitter. I don't know how many of you use Facebook, but we've got lots of competitions on there. We give lots of books away. So if you want to find us on Facebook, feel free. You might win a book. So this is Spineout. This is something that is fairly new. It's about 3 years old. And this is something that we really want to highlight today. It's a young adults magazine for the ages 13 to about 18. So your high school demographic. It's all about getting the students to express themselves. The way it works is we want the content to mainly be from the students. So the idea is that the students will create something, whether that be a book review, which is one of the main things that we feature in the magazine, a short story, a poem, and whatever sort of media that comes in, Spineout can handle it. So if somebody writes a review, we can publish that. If they talk a review, so they video themselves doing it, they can do that. We've got book trailers, music lyrics, and poetry. And this is what Spineout will look like. It's online only. So every issue, you'll have a few different pages, and everything's on the actual magazine. These days, you know, I don't know if you have found this, but young adults only want a little bit of information, and then they get bored with it, so they go on to the next one. So if they want to read more, they have the option to click into it and read more. A few different features is you just pretty much click the pages and it slides back. You can see here that you've got all the books on one page. This is what I was talking about before, where you just have to click on the actual book cover and it'll come up with the information of the student who has written the review, a little bit of information about them. That is optional. You can put as much information or as little. That's up to the discretion of the school. And then they have the book review, which we provide a style guide for. Another great thing about this is we provide the books so they can write from a book that they've read, or you can call us up and say, I've got a student who's interested in fantasy. Do you have a book that you can send out? The students can then read the book and keep the book when they send a review. So that's a really good incentive for the kids. This page, we've got more work. So you'll notice here that there's a button that says, click here. So this girl has actually written she's actually sung a song. She's written the song and she's recorded the song, so you can click on that and you can hear what she's actually submitted to us. So it's kind of versatile. It's all wrapped around words, you know, writing and things like that, whatever way, shape or form that comes in. This story of a gingerbread man was quite cute because he's an autistic boy from an autistic school, and he did his whole story, he wrote it in paint. And then it went through a little sideshow, and that was really nice to see. His photos are quite cute there. We've got manga, we've got artwork. Again, it's just a few features that we have, all very interactive. And again, the students can click on more if they want to read more about that particular content. We also have video features. So we've had students actually interview authors, and they've videoed them doing the interview, and then it just clicks on. We don't use YouTube. So it's not going to be blocked. We use Vimeo, so it's our own account, so schools shouldn't have any trouble actually accessing the videos. And it's really easy to browse. So every month, we'll obviously, bi-monthly actually, which is a bi-monthly magazine, we'll feature the latest magazine. But you can actually browse all the issues just by using the tabs at the bottom. It tells you all the issues that we've had. You can go all the way to the archives. We started in 2010. You can then look at the contents, and then you can go into all of the pages. So it's really easy to sort of browse whatever issue you want to go to. Now, these are the packages that we have for schools. If you're interested, we also have free trials. The trials will let you access both Good Reading Online as well as Spineout Online. They go for about a month, and these are all the different sort of packages that we bundle, depending if you want the print, if you want one of the onlines, if you want everything, and we sort of just set you all up with a unique URL if you want to go for the online. But again, if you want a trial, try before you buy. Just contact us. There should actually be a little flyer in the little book bags. We gave you guys some nice little show bags there. It has all the information about what Spineout can offer, the trials and the contact details. And again, here's some more information on how to contact us if you guys want to jot those down. I also will pass around this e-news sign-up form if you want to start getting some of those e-newsletters. It'll have more information here. That's it. I think we have some questions now. Do we have time for questions?
Okay, anyone around the room? I'd like to start it off, actually, Bonnie, by asking you about the browse facility for the past 3 years. If it's just a browse facility, does that mean basically you can't search? So there's something that might have come out, you decide that you want to see if it's there. You can't search it, you can only browse it.
You can search it. The searching facilities are going to get better. So basically you can search any sort of keyword. So you can search about an author, and it'll actually bring up what magazine that features to, and it hyperlinks straight through to that magazine. So it goes straight there. You can search a kid's name or just keywords and things like that.
Any other questions?
You know the reader guide for the ages?
Yes. Yep.
When you go into that, is it subject based as well, or just purely a list of titles?
I think you can actually go by. I think you can go by title and even author, if I'm correct.
And it's based on our reviews, so you can actually search by review. So the higher the star rating would come up first. So the most popularly reviewed books will show on the list.
But there's not a thematic base, so if you want to put some friendship for 4-year-olds.
Not yet, no. We are revisiting our website early next year, and it will be relaunched in March, and it will be completely overhauled, and we'll have categories by that stage.
You can search the website as well, so if you know the author or the title of it, you can actually just, there's always a search box at the top there, and it brings up everything with that sort of title in it. Any other
questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Bonnie.
No worries.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
This is guided more to seniors because that's who I work with, so apologies if it's not really relevant, but I'm finding it's a great forerunner to kids before they get to university because it's an introduction to bigger and better databases. This is what I run through with the seniors. I vary it according to whether it's an orientation or whether I'm presenting to a CAFS class, which is Community and Family Studies, or Society and Culture. Both subjects have what they call PIPs and IRPs, Individual Research Projects and Personal Interest Projects, just so I don't get you bogged down in acronyms.
Are you able to email this or put it up?
Yes, definitely. I'm just going to fly through quite a few slides and leave you to read them rather than me state the obvious, because we're on 5 minutes. These are the objectives I'll present to the students as well as at the beginning. It's a great advertisement to promote our databases, which is subscribed to by CEO. And I plug that all the time, both with students and staff. I've even presented to staff on the same thing. I explain to them what makes up a database, the difference between full text, full content, and e-journals, a lot of which they don't understand. I find once they get into actually searching, they know what I'm talking about, but it doesn't hurt to tell them all this because, again, university, they will need to know the difference. Go through the basics of the periodical. Some don't even know what that is, sadly. And this is why I present them to use the databases. The same as with a lot of other databases, your searching's already done to a certain degree to authenticate your articles. They're written by people of note in their field, and if they search widely enough, they will get different viewpoints. And the other good thing with certain subjects is, with the limiters on it, you can actually search within the last 2 years, 1 year, last month, whatever. Again, I know this for a fact from my daughters that are studying, they only really want articles from the last 5 years, unless of course you're looking at something historical. It fits quite nicely into the information literacy, which is old school information skills. It's just a lot broader now. So we're still focusing on the big six. It also promotes other issues that I make students aware of. The ethical use of using online things, acknowledging the source, plagiarism, and also about their digital footprint, just making them aware of that. This is just screenshots how we access it. I also get the kids to log on because through the student portal, it's actually much clearer. You've got, I think, an access point to eLibrary, the database, and two other things which I can't remember. But from a library point of view, when they come in, if they don't log in, I just point out how they access it through the computer. And they can actually access all databases at once. Down the bottom there, it says all databases, EBSCO. But today, I generally start with this one because the platform presents quite nicely to the students without confusing them too much. You can search across all those categories, and it does default with all the boxes ticked. It's not moving on. Okay, I don't actually go into this, but if they want to search particular journal titles, you can get the list of hundreds up there. I kind of do that to make a point, just to show them how much each database does cover. I think in this instance I use the term business, search by subject description, and it's brought up, I think, 160 titles. Not that I really advocate they search by title, but I just give them that option that it is there. They're the five key steps that I go through, search. The facets you'll see are the different points on the page. You can focus it like with primary sources, newspaper articles, magazines, etc. I go through this with them because they generally don't know the word boolean. The and or not, because they're also used to using Google, take the first one at the top of the page. And I find this really good because teachers don't quite often understand this process either. So I'm not only teaching the students, the teachers have often said, oh, I didn't know that. And for the more advanced, next slide, you can actually truncate your search using various keyboard shortcuts. As I said, I don't really go into that too much because I find it a bit overwhelming. Same with that. Smart text searching is another box I point out because if all else fails, they have no idea what to put in the first line box. They can virtually put in a sentence, what they want, but it does only search on the keywords within that. And I do tell them it's not going to, you know, type your assignment in and bang, there comes your answer. It's still a good thing to point out. I'm just whizzing through all of this because it's actually showing a particular search that I did with them on history. You can actually search by topic as well, narrow as you go, bring up results, refine your results according to document type. History often use primary resources, that's why I picked this one. Narrow it down even further by speeches, addresses, so we're now down to, you know, one of 34. And then you can add them to a folder. Now I really go into a bit of detail how they can do this because they don't have time to sit and read and discern which is suitable. So they add it to the folder, saves it, They then have the option of saving, emailing, printing, also a choice of citation. I really plug that as well because it's a big part of their assessment is bibliography and citing. In my day, you had to work it out yourself. Now it comes through in the article, all done for you. I think the only two not on that list, this is what it would look like. It either comes through HTML or PDF as an attachment. I would normally run this little flash video. It's 3 minutes and I recommend using that because succinctly it gives them a brief introduction to it and they're all off the EBSCO website on support tutorials. I won't do it today because we'll probably be... So that's a recap on the databases. Search for authenticated titles, the abstract is there, if they want it, full text. Harvard and Oxford, I think, are the two that aren't on the list. They use the operators, and the big thing I tell them, they don't have to get their backside off the seat. Plus, you've got access to all those databases as well, the other ones, which I, you know, take time to point out. And that's it.
During Helen's presentation, I was actually just emailing my CAFS coordinator to remind him that they need to come and see me. And lucky for my daughter, she's in one of those classes. We also share databases a lot at Mary and I play it all the time. Can you give us an idea if we're doing all right for usage? Is it still going to continue to be subscribed?
I'll have to look when it comes again.
Yeah.
I mean, each year...
But we're looking all right?
Yeah, it's been looking good. It's been increasing, so which has been good, really good. So we just need to keep plugging it and keep increasing it.
Mm.
But definitely the EBSCO databases have been increasing over time. So
I've got 5 coordinators with database searching mandatory in assignments in year 11 and 12.
And I do it part of learning orientation, and all the kids have to actually find an article on a topic and email it to me to prove that they know how to do it. So, you know, there's 200 students every year at least.
And apart from numbers, they have that anecdotal as well because they want to see it being linked to learning.
Yeah.
So when I send out that email, it's really important when you give me that, just that little, you know,
one-liner
that just says this is what we're doing with it.
Yeah.
And that really helps.
So if those of you who aren't using databases, if we can remember to just keep feeding to Lisa the use and the evidence. Actually, it also inspired me to ask another quick question. I'm sorry to the primary people. Those in high school, can you give me a show of hands if you still use Harvard as your referencing style? APA?
Yeah, which is similar. But I find some subjects really want one. And I know history, like Oxford. So I can't advocate one system for the whole school because it doesn't work.
Well, I've only got one KLA asking and they want APA. And I just found when you use Word to write your bibliography, and I teach the kids to do this,
that's good.
You have to download the Harvard plugin, whereas APA, MLA, they all come standard. And I'm just wondering if we're just seeing a push to
I know at university a lot it's APA 6th edition they're using, so that's another good reason to be going with that.
Yeah, and that's why I get two.
Sorry? It
depends on what subject.
That's what I said. I know our history people use Oxford.
Yes.
Yeah, but still.
Does anyone have any questions of Helen?
Did you say you were going to share that?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
We'll try and get all the PowerPoints together and put them somewhere.
Okay, so, terrific. All right. Thanks very much, Helen.
Okay, thanks.
Welcome.
That was great. And thank you. That's just a little. Thank you.
Carol. Afternoon, everyone. I just felt like making a formal start. This is a bit on the lighter end of the scale. This event, Writepath International, was on at the time that Lisa was asking for the submissions, and I was a bit excited at the time, so put myself down quite out of my comfort zone. I'm not the only one that does this. Jan, who was before me at Delany, started it there and is a personal friend of the founder. And and you're the famous Sarah Cook who made the...
I was just going to say, that mind the kids.
Right. So anyway, in the spirit of sharing, this is what we did. And so I sort of picked it up when I came there last year. And it's suitable for the junior secondary end and obviously primary schools as well. So I'd say stage three or stage four. It's basically a Ning that hosts an annual collaborative short story writing event. It originates in Britain. It faltered a little bit last year and then came good with schools coming on. So I think they had a ballpark figure of about 58 schools worldwide involved in it. So it's not huge, but you know, it's a manageable type event, and that's what I love about it. Kicks off with a bunch of British authors and poets writing starters for collaborative projects. Runs in October each year, and it gets posted to a blog. So what the students see when they log on the morning that they're timetabled is a starter for their story. So an author posts a beginning, and we bring in some writing teams. We've got six stories on the go. We sort of peg out a room like this, and we have media teams taking photos and doing videos, and six writing teams. So they get this starter. The beauty of it is it's over in an hour. So I had sort of looked at doing write a book in the day, and the scale of the commitment just overwhelmed me, and I sort of felt, no, my school community is not up to this. So this was so much more doable. You get this posted, and one of the advantages of being on the other side of the world from the people in Britain had been, until more schools in Australia got on board, that you had that, you know, the dateline or the timeline in your favour, that you would log on, and if you'd gone on at 9 or 9.30 rather than your 10 o'clock starting time, you know, all the better. You could do a bit of pre-reading and a bit of brainstorming before your hour started. And that if you got really busy at recess, you know, and you were a bit late posting, it wouldn't matter. But that, you know, that advantage is starting to fade away now as more schools in the Southern Hemisphere are coming online. So essentially, your students have to come up with a paragraph. It's not very long. So that all they have to do is get to grips with the, just the story writing genre. And, the things that come up are the kind... You're looking at 12-year-olds, and some of them, you know, get so excited that they almost kill the story by, you know, oh yeah, let's have the characters die, you know, or let's have, you know, have this happen or that happen. And at the other end of it, you've got these people who have their dictionaries out and are writing really long, detailed descriptions of everything, and you say, well, actually, it'll read a little more, be a little bit more edgy if you, take it down a notch, you know, use shorter sentences. So it's a good expose of the story writing art. At the interest side of things, you have the opportunity to get the kids involved in taking photos, doing videos. So our students did an introductory video. So there's an opportunity to connect with schools in other countries. So, there are international schools involved, schools in Asia, schools in the Middle East and in the United States as well. So you can get your kids involved in, you know, making a video, editing a video. So you can, you know, tap into other parts of the curriculum so that you can do those connections with other people. Okay. So, yeah, basically that just won't run. Okay, so there you go. I've turned the sound off because they're all... because the sound's not very useful at the moment. With that running in the background, I just like as the brief points, benefits, manageable. So manageable, you have to have some access to the kids beforehand, one, to do the media stuff, two, to do a bit of preparation. On the day, it gets done and it's almost over. It's great for their writing skills, great for making the kids feel good, especially if you are in a fairly literacy challenged school like I am, you know, because they feel really special for having done it. It's great if you are feeling under a bit of pressure to have a little bit of a program of events running, and you know you need to be in the newsletter or the year, you know, or have lots of things to go in the yearbook. So manageable in those sense. Difficulties I've found is in a busy school, and this is everyone, getting access to students is okay for your target group, but if you really wanted to bring it to the whole year group, access to classes can be limited. You know, I was able to do a little follow-up with the classes, but just the once, you know, and there is so much on there and in there that you could do with kids on writing and, you know, really just building that love of story that you you know, there's always frustrations in trying to get that access. Cost, $130 to participate. Which is great, you know, considering I had 16 kids, you know, really engaged for a two-week period leading up to and after the event. So I guess that's it from me. Unless there are any questions? Oh, Jan.
Would you add what happens to the story? What happens after the six or eight schools over 24 hours post their paragraphs? What happens next?
Okay. Well, it is a blog, so it is interactive, and so people do a reflection.
Yeah. I was really meaning that the author takes back the story and edits it, and it gets published in that little book.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's not in the immediate period, so... So at the beginning of next year, and I have an example of this in my bag, which I'll pass around after this, you know, I would just sort of, in my excitement to get up here, I left it behind. But it is published in book form, and that is so cool by the kids, you know, that they are in a book. You know, so at the beginning of the year, I will pass that around to the kids, you know, so they actually get published. So I'll just pass that copy from last year around when I'm back.
How did you get your 16? How did you put it out there?
I emailed the English staff and said nominate for me, and they gave me, you know, some of their best students and some of their crazy students with great ideas, you know, and you know, so that's essentially what we came up with.
I guess having that immediate aspect though, you can involve other kids that aren't so much wanting to
put in keyboard and keyboard. So they were a lot of the ideas people. I said, go around, take photos. Yeah, and so, yeah. Sometimes you find your best writers, especially with the young ones, are the ones who are laboriously writing really long descriptions, and the you know, some of the people who aren't, you know, sort of acknowledged as good writers come in with the ideas, you know, hey, what about, you know. So we had a lot of cross-fertilisation with the ideas in it. So, yeah, worthwhile. And... yeah, totally recommended, even. Congratulations again, Sarah.
Thinking of primary experience, because we do write drama compare as well, where I take the top 20 Year 6 students. For this Writepath, in the last couple of years, I've taken the lowest 12, because we have the 6 stories, so I put 2 children on a paragraph each, and I get our ESL teacher to come in and help, just to give those children at the bottom of the class something that they can feel good about. This year we had it slightly differently because my wife didn't get access to the ESL teachers. So I took the middle group of kids. So I still didn't take my top 20 writers. I took the next 12 here or there, and a couple of, you know, kids we just didn't want to because they just have behavioural problems. And so I think, and of course, this is the 3rd year that I've done it, so I've gotten better at it as well, managing the time for the children and giving them hints as to what they can do. So you really need to encourage them to finish their paragraph with somewhere to go, with a question. So they're not in their paragraph, they need to be able to lead the next people on to write. So, and I've learned that over the years, that, you know, they tend to finish it off, right, that's it, it's ended. So it's very hard for the next school to add something on. So I think you see they did it much better. They were able to write some fabulous things, which is good.
Obviously they did.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any questions from the rear of the room?
Okay.
Lorraine's going to talk about her scaffold for guided inquiry. Thanks.
Can I ask what school you're from, darling?
Holy Spirit Primary School out at Sinclair.
Thank you.
I'm aware that the CEO are bringing out some professional development around project-based learning. And I really don't know how what we're doing will marry up with what we're going to present. So I'm not suggesting that this is the way. It's just our way at the moment while we wait for something better. Our school has been involved in an inquiry model for classroom teachers K-6 in Hessian science for a number of years now. The idea is that after a few weeks of teaching whatever the current unit is, the children then pursue their own research. So they're asked to come up with their own question and then to carry out their research and to create some kind of model to present their learning. So it might be anything from a glove puppet, cardboard, clay, podcast, iMovie, depending on their audience. And the children really love the creation side of it. And they like actually having that freedom of choice to pursue something they're interested in. But the problem is there were difficulties come along with that as well. What teachers found was that the children really weren't able to formulate a really good question. Questions were either much too broad, what is Antarctica like, or much too narrow, what plant grows on the permafrosted Mawson Station. And lots of children simply weren't able to come up with any question at all. The other problem that teachers found with the children doing the research was they just couldn't understand the websites that they were pulling up. Either the articles were too long, they weren't at their instructional reading level, they didn't really know how to use the menus terribly well, or they were filled with technical language. And so the children started to become overwhelmed by the task. And if every child's doing their own task, the teacher is also pulling her hair out, trying to help, you know, 30 people with different ideas. And so frustration set in and children reverted to a copy and paste mentality. To combat that, stage two and three teachers decided to do a little bit of a mini unit around, you know, what is a rich question and what constitutes a site of authority. And for a little while things improved, but teachers' expectations rose higher than the gains made by students. And so again, that frustration crept in. So the reason behind all of this is that research is hard. You know, it's hard for secondary school kids, it's hard for university students, it's hard for us as adults in tertiary education. So for little people, when you add, you know, they've got learning difficulties or a short attention span, maybe they're not particularly fluent in English. And what we find at our school, those who aren't particularly fluent in English are also not fluent in their mother tongue, which makes it harder again to learn English. And research is really difficult when you're just an emerging reader. And what was happening was that I found more and more teachers were coming to me asking me for some kind of guidance in this overall process. And I had a model for library that I was reasonably happy with. I had many, many moons of refining it. And so I started to think, you know, how we could use this model to help teachers. And the problem was the model was in my head, so I spent a little bit of reading time and then started to get the model on paper to help classroom teachers. This book really was a catalyst for what I did. And I'll just read this quote to you. Carol Coulthard is saying, this is a 2007 publication, "Students often have great difficulty in the early stages of the inquiry process. Even when they begin with great enthusiasm, and we certainly saw that at our school, many soon became confused and uncertain about how to proceed. This sense of uncertainty is an indication of a need for assistance and instruction, a zone of intervention. Students need intervention tailored to each stage of the inquiry process to move them then to real inquiry-based learning." So looking at that, I figured, okay, this is just like reading. I think what we were doing was expecting the children to be able to read the technical journal without having taught them, you know, the basics of reading. And so I really thought long and hard about this as I put this little scaffold together for teachers. So the scaffold that I put together relies on three short, structured sessions of research to arrive at a final product. So for the children to say, I'm finished, three sessions of research, but each one of them short. Each session requires explicit teaching and modelling by the classroom teacher. So the first bout of research is from a primary source. I'll come back to that. The second bout of research is from a bulk loan of books from the library. And the third lot of research comes from websites. So if we have a look at the primary source, so I'm advocating that the primary source is a piece of information that every single student has access to at the same time, and it should be at the student's instructional level. Quite often this means that you, the teacher, write it. You're familiar with the unit of work, and so whatever you're asking your children to do some research from, I've found it pretty easy really to knock up a few slides or a few slides on the whiteboard at their instructional level. So it could just be a few slides in a PowerPoint, a few pages in a flip chart, a piece of text but no more than a few paragraphs, a child-friendly website, or it could be, as we saw earlier, one of those wonderful articles from World Book Kids. Also for the little people, and I'm talking stage one, it might be an object or an illustration. So when we start to do the research, straight away the material's accessible, it's readable and it's understandable because the teacher has ensured that it is. And then with the model, I've actually got it here, it tells the teacher step by step what to do. So with this initial slide, the teacher would go through the first, say the slide was two slides, the whole part thing that they were looking at, we'd talk about, well, what's the main idea here? And how do we know it's the main idea? And are there any sentences or phrases that justify that this really is the main idea? Are there some pictures or photographs to support that? The thing is, we know this process well. Classroom teachers haven't used it before. And so it's really foreign to them. And so I found that they really didn't have an understanding of how to do this. So the scaffold sets it out for them step by step. And so then we look at the keywords. And again, the teacher models on the screen, you know, what do you think the keywords could be and why are we going to call them keywords and how do they support what we thought was the main idea? And so after the selection of the keywords, then together as a class, they might put that writing together again as a group effort in their own words so that the teacher is explicitly modelling what the children need to do and they do it together as a class. And that very short session, the children might end up with half a page of research done, and yes, it's the same as everybody else's, but it's been modelled really well and supported at every step of the way. Well, that concludes the first little part of the research. The second part is a research from bulk loan books. So if we're talking about Antarctica, the teacher then pulls out the bulk loan books and presents them to the children. And now the teacher has the opportunity to actually teach about contents pages and index pages and how they're arranged. And then the students are invited to choose a book and to go through the contents and index and see if they can find an area of interest to them. And so this part is giving them back a little bit of that freedom that we originally wanted. So they could use the contents and index to find something that they're really, really interested in. And then when they've decided what they want to research, the answer is already in their hand. The teacher also takes the opportunity to talk about, you know, headings, bold headings, and how they might be reflecting some of the key words, to have a look at how the illustrations support the text on the page. So again, it really comes down to explicit teaching and modelling. So then the teacher actually models what's required at this step with an example book, and after that the children then work perhaps with a partner or at groups of three to decide together what they would like to research from a particular book and to decide what's the main idea and the keywords, and then together build those back up into notes of their own. They then write a very simple bibliography for the book, and the teacher has a guide for that too. Again, always explicit teaching, explicit modelling. Then the third session of research, and this will complete their research on whatever their project is, well, it'd be something about Antarctica in this case. The students use websites to find additional facts, and I do usually ask teachers to do a little bit of homework before they present the topic and to find a few suitable websites for the children and have them on the data drive ready to go. The teacher now takes the opportunity to teach children how to skim and scan. Have a look at some of the keywords we were pulling out before, because this is the topic that we're doing. Now we're looking for these same keywords coming up again. This time, though, the children only have to find one or two extra facts to complement what they've already done. So it's, again, it's making it doable. They're not feeling overwhelmed by a huge mountain of information, so skimming and scanning to find a few extra facts to complement the work that they've already done. The teacher also takes this opportunity to teach what is a site of authority. How is .gov and .org different to .com? And is there anything wrong with .com? Maybe we can compare it to another few sites. And is there an author? And are there spelling mistakes? And all the things that, that we know so well. But all of this is new to the classroom teacher, and that's why I felt they needed a really step-by-step scaffold. Once the children have found two or three interesting facts, they then create a little bibliography for that, and that's the end of their written research for that topic. They might end up with two, maybe three pages of work. The first page is identical to everybody else's, but after that it's their own work. The difference is it's doable in the classroom, and even though it's short, it's good stuff. And then they've got the remaining weeks to translate whatever they've learned into the part that they were enjoying most in the first place, to creating, you know, some type of presentation for a particular audience. So this little guide provides a good scaffold on how to research, and it just teaches the students the steps. So again, I felt it was really akin to teaching the steps to, that children require to be fluent readers. They need to go right back to these guided inquiry so that one day they can do their own independent research and inquiry. By narrowing the focus, it also allows children to do more in-depth in a specific area rather than just a wide, nebulous, overwhelming, you know, if anything to do with Antarctica will do. It makes them more of an expert in a smaller area, but gives more depth to it. And by chunking the research in this way, it's much less overwhelming. So I'll just finish with that Carol Coulthard's statement that students need intervention tailored to each stage of the inquiry process to move them to real inquiry-based learning. This really is just a step-by-step, but on the back, because it's really a note-making guide and a how-to guide, I have tried to give it a bit more quality and depth, and this is something that not a lot of teachers have taken up yet because they're still managing with the scaffold. But it's creating a question for the children or for the class to interact with during the course of the unit. So for this one's on the unit of gold, so the teacher just has on the wall, was the discovery of gold a good thing for Australia and why? And the children are encouraged to ask their parents at home, ask the neighbour, whatever, and just come in with a little yellow sticky note and put their answer up. And their put in sections of yes, no, yes and no. And so the children really have an opportunity then to give a bit more depth to the discussion, and every now and then, just before morning tea or just before lunch, the teacher would read one out and they'd have a discussion around that. So it just gives the whole topic that little bit more of more depth. The next stage is that children could start identifying, well, my answer, was it part of my prior learning? Did I know it beforehand? Is it something that I have learned during this unit of work? Or is it something that I've been able to infer? So then they're actually starting to label their own thinking as well. We have two classes in our school that are really getting enthusiastic about this part of it. The other thing it could be used for, I call it Q&A, question and answer, but I really think it stands for quality assurance. You could give the students one of the statements each and ask them to come up with a caption or heading for it. Have the students participate in a modified debate on one of the questions and answers that came up. Choose one of the statements and have the class find how many supporting facts they can gather for that statement, and a few more ideas go on there. So that's it from me.
Just to comment from me, we spend a lot of our time in high school just wanting to know when we're supposed to be your kids. And if we saw models like this coming through, and kids who've had this rich learning experience, the scaffold in primary, where they're coming to high school with those skills, we'd beat our head against the wall a lot less. And so I think, really, congratulations to you for doing something like this. You are going to make such a difference to their schooling life, especially when they get to high school. And PBL, QBL, CBL, or however you want to paraphrase it, that kind of thinking they're saying now is, this is mimicking the real world skills that the kids need to have. So good for you for providing it at primary school, and I think that's, you know, it's a great thing. And the kids who go to high schools on will certainly benefit from the things that you've certainly started at your level. So does anyone have any questions?
I'd like to reiterate that, and I think that you need to really get that out there, Lorraine, because I think it's a great scaffold that, if you're willing to share it with, you know, lots of people, I think we need to. And I know that when I showed it to Gary Brown here, and he was very impressed as well. So I think, yeah, you know, just try and get it out there to lots of people as well, because it will be a really great resource.
There's a copy here of it if you want.
I know when you said the teachers when you get those websites set up suitable. Here's the public one already with the live groups.
Yeah.
Because that can cater to different levels. Yeah. You know,
So thank you, Lorraine.
Okay, there's some copies there if anybody wants
them.
Thank
you. And where's Carol?
Thank you.
Liz is going to tell us all about RDA in 10 minutes.
Wow, that's going to be a crash course, isn't it?
How many days?
3 days. 3 days I spent in Canberra learning about this.
Responses from people that are
online,
they're saying the picture's very clear, the sound's very clear, and they're getting lots of great info. So, another question is there? Well, the question that I missed? Okay, maybe we have a copy as well. So, first of all, I have to find out who this is, because they haven't, on this chat, you're all anonymous unless you actually write your name. So, I'll find out who it is. And then I'm sure Lorraine would be happy to email them a copy, would you?
Sure.
Okay.
Okay, fantastic. Can I just say, it's been great watching your brief presentation, just seeing how information is used in schools and things like that, and that's just great from my point of view, just sort of seeing how the information's used. Okay, now I apologise, mine is going to be more technical, so it's a bit late now, but that's okay, we'll see how we go. Okay, firstly, can anybody tell me, do they know what RDA is, apart from being writing from Disabled Association? Because when I Google RDA, that's the answer I actually get, is writing for Disabled Association. So can anybody actually tell me, Sarah?
Is it resource description access?
Well done. Yes, it is.
Sarah, you
can tell who's actually done exactly what it is. It's resource description and access. So what is resource description and access? It is the new international cataloguing standard for libraries designed for digital resources. So this is what we actually are having to replace ACR2 or AACR2. Okay? So some of you may or may not be familiar with ACR2. It is a cataloguing standard which was developed in 1978, and a lot has changed since 1978. In that stage, most of our resources were printed. We had all things on catalogue cards, and catalogue cards were limited, the amount of information you could put onto a catalogue card. So we had to write things in abbreviation, and we had a lot of a Latin shorthand things and things like that. So things have changed a bit since then, and we now have marked catalogue records, which allow us to put more information into a record. So we have lots of notes fields and lots of information that we want to put into catalogue records these days. So what is RDA then? It's based upon a theoretical principle called FERBA, and is designed for digital resources, and it's been developed by the Joint Steering Committee for the Development of RDA, so it's an international organisation. Back in 2005, they were trying to look at redoing ACR2, so they actually came up with ACR3 and started writing it through, but they realised that it was just too limited in terms of describing the digital resources we were dealing with these days. So they just totally scrapped ACR2 and have moved to this new version here, or new principle, called RDA, which is based upon this concept of FERBA. FERBA talks about relationships, and it talks about trust in our relationships and things like that. So it's based upon this principle of data creating links to resources in our catalogue. So I'm just going to read you something about FERBA firstly before we get started. Our catalogue no longer exists in isolation. With the proliferation of the internet and the explosion has led to the volume and availability information, library catalogues need to be able to adapt to this environment in order to remain relevant. RDA is designed to support the creation of data that can be used and shared much more easily in this online environment. So it's important to be aware of some of the broad developments in data management and sharing. So if we look back at what's happened on the internet since probably the late 80s, really, we've got Web 1, which is that concept of the early concept where we just searched and got a Google page up and things like that. We couldn't actually write to the web at all. It was that concept of keywords, information was there, drilling down from the top. We then moved to Web 2, which allowed us to write to the web. So we had the rise of social media and social content in terms of all the MySpace and Facebook and things like that. That's the Web 2 concept. We allowed us to write to the web and to develop things on the web. The thing we're now moving to is what is called semantic web. And semantic web is about enabling computers to understand the meaning behind the information that they are sharing. Web pages are enhanced by inserting machine-readable metadata into the pages and how they relate to each other. When a computer accesses a web page, the metadata tells the computer not only what is needed, but how it relates to other web pages. So it involves semantic data. Web involves asking questions, looking at relationships, and it's also based upon the premise of trust as well too. So that illustration there is that concept of semantic web where everything is interlocked together and it's searching multiple relationships and things like that. Okay, so just going back to what I said before, the internet is computers talking to each other. Semantic web is computers understanding what they're talking about. And there's a little YouTube video. It's actually 6 minutes. I'm not going to show it to you now, but I'm happy to email around to you. And it talks about this concept of semantic web and where we're moving to in terms of data and things like that. Okay, so that's a bit of background to where they've developed RDA from, where it's come from, and why we're moving the way we are, and what FERBA might be. So FERBA actually stands for Functional Requirements for Bibliographic Records. And it's also based upon a principle of FRAD, which is actually subject heading. So it's Functional Requirements for Authority. So those are the two principles that underline RDA. Okay, so when we're looking at RDA, it's based into four different entities. We have a work, we have the expression, we have the manifestation, and we have the item. Now, to give you a bit of an idea of the concept of this, I've actually got some pictures here, but you can't see them, which is making it a bit hard. What it is, it's actually eight different photocopies of Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice. So we've got different editions. We've actually, this one here is the original one, a hardback book of it. This is an audio book of it. So we've got an audio book of Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice. We've got the BBC DVD production of Pride and Prejudice. We have an e-book, Pride and Prejudice. We have a novel of Pride and Prejudice. So this is the original going back, published in 1813. We also have an unabridged audio recording of Pride and Prejudice. We have Pride and Prejudice and the Zombies. We have a Pride and Prejudice, this deluxe two-disc DVD set. And we then have a Blu-ray version of Pride and Prejudice, as well as a DVD of Pride and Prejudice. So understanding this concept of looking at works, expressions and manifestations, I was actually going to put these up with blue tap, but I think that's going to be too hard because you won't be able to see them. But going back to that concept, they're all one work, they're all Pride and Prejudice. So with Ferber, what it does, it says they're all one idea. They're all starting from that originator and they all come from that concept. They might have many different expressions. So we've got a different expression might be the zombie one. So it sort of starts off with that same concept, but it's different expression. Pride and Prejudice and the Zombies. They've then got different expressions because you've got the BBC production, which is different to the one that was done with Keira Knightley in it. So you've got, once again, different expressions of that particular work. So that whole concept of they're all Pride and Prejudice, but they are expressed in different ways. So they then manifest in different ways as well. Manifest refers to how it is displayed. So you may have a DVD, you may have an audio book, you might have an abridged, you might have an unabridged audio book. You may have it an e-book reader. So they're different displays of that same information, but in different formats. And then it comes down to item. Okay, so that is the individual item we have in our library. So just to give you a bit of an example, we have a book here, Group 1 Entities. Whose bottom is that? Okay, that is a work, okay? So it's somebody's work. It's expressed through its text and its illustrations. And the manifestation is actually your print run, your ISBN, your edition, and your series. And then it is actually the library's copy, which is the item information. Okay? So I realise it took me a whole day to get my head around this concept, and I don't expect you to get your head around what we're talking about now. But this is what you're going to see a change when people start talking about information. These are the changes people are going to be talking about when they talk about Ferber, and they talk about the concept of a work and an idea and linking ideas together. So it's that sharing information and linking of resources together. And then it comes back to a person, a family, and a corporate. And the work is created by somebody. So in that case, it's created by Wayne Lynch. The text and the illustrations is realised by Wayne Lynch. The manifestation is the edition, the publisher, and the series. So it's that local information which relates to that particular copy. That's your bibliographic data, which goes together as part of that. And then your local call number becomes your item information. So these are all linked together. We have entities, attributes, and relationships, and they're all linked together, and that's what people are going to be searching on. And the relationships between them, we've got a book up here, and that's the idea. So that's the genius of the author. So that's supposed to be the old concept of an author having an idea. It then develops into the title, and over here it's related to the publisher. So the publisher is a person who puts those ideas together and publishes it for them. Okay, So what does it all mean for us? I mean, I've talked about a whole lot of theoretical concepts. How is that going to impact upon us here in Parramatta Diocese, and what can we expect to see? Okay, well, firstly, RDA is going to mean there's going to be no more GMD is general material designate in the statement. So when we look at a title record or record of a resource like Pride and Prejudice, you'd have Pride and Prejudice, and then the square brackets you have video recording or audiobook or whatever. That format is going to disappear out of the title record, okay? So it'll just be Pride and Prejudice, whatever. It won't actually tell you video recording. It's going to be replaced by three more marked tags in the catalogue record instead, okay? So the catalogue records are going to allow greater searching and granulation of information for better searching. So that's what we'll be seeing in there. All our Latin abbreviations have gone. No more et als and things like that. Because we're not limited by information anymore, we don't have to put everything onto a catalogue card, so therefore things can be written in full. And for those who are actually doing the cataloguing, they'll be able to write exactly what it says, transcribed from the book itself. The rule of three for the authors, which is the et al. One. So previously, if you had about four or five authors for a particular textbook, you would have the first author and then you put et al. Et al. They're now going to be listed, so you'll actually have all authors listed. However, in a normal catalogue record, you still have your main author and the other authors be listed in the 700s as added authors. Abbreviations like P for page and IL will actually become full words, so you'll have pages and illustrations as opposed to that. And not that I think a lot's been done about, just haven't actually used the concept of uniform title very much, but it's going to be replaced by the term preferred title. And this is where it's actually going to become that linking information, because you're going to be linking preferred titles together, like Pride and Prejudice. All these things which are Pride and Prejudice will be linked together in the catalogue in some way. At the moment, a lot of our library management systems aren't going to deal with this concept of FERBA at the moment. So over the next 10 years, we'll probably see a change in the way data is actually handled in our records to allow for this linking of data. But this is sort of the beginning of that change at the moment. So what does that actually mean for us? Apart from the fact that we're going to see changes in our catalogue records. Currently, SCIS are still working out what they're going to do in terms of all this. They've actually got a working party going together. The training session I went to in Canberra, there was actually a person from SCIS actually gone to the previous one, and they were going back and they were having lots of talks and working parties about how they're actually going to, what level of cataloguing they were going to take that to in terms of information. So they will be, you'll be seeing different catalogue records come from them. The Library of Congress and National Library have actually both said they will be introducing this from January to March. So basically, probably by March, they would have to have most of their catalogue records coming out in the RDA format. So it's just a question of time before it rolls out. From our point of view in Symphony Workflows, we're actually really well positioned in terms of this. Talking to people from SCIS, they're actually not particularly worried about us. They said, you've got a library management system that can cope with that, as opposed to a lot of other library systems which they didn't feel could cope with that. So they said, look, no, you're in a really good position. Cersei Dynex are actually doing a release in they're doing a test one in, it's actually Valentine's Day, the 14th of February, they've got a release coming through. So I'm going to put that on the test server, and then hopefully in April school holidays we'll do an upgrade which will actually put the tags into our database. So we're fairly well positioned in terms of that. So from your point of view, you'll see a few different things in catalogue records. I am planning on running, for those who are really into cataloguing and our cataloguing team, I will be running RDA courses, which will actually go through and explain the data to them, the changes to them. And there is an online toolkit that you subscribe to. It's called RDA Toolkit. And there will be some people who will probably be giving access to that. On the whole, most of you won't really need access to it. You don't need it in a day-to-day basis. But it's just so you understand the changes and why you're going to see the change in the catalogue records.
So these will be only on records coming in?
Yes.
Not retrospective?
No, that's exactly right. Not retrospective at all. No, it's only incoming. That's exactly right. And we won't, I have no intention of going back and tidying up. in fact, it was interesting, that was a conversation point actually at conference at that I went to, and I thought, no way.
Does that mean that sort of accessing then to websites, to our catalogues, going to be more effective?
Probably Probably not, but yes, eventually it will be, but not for that. There's actually other reasons why that will be the case. Cersei Dynex is shipping out another product called eResource Central, which will actually allow us to actually search websites as part of that. But that's a bit further down the track, and that's something else. But no, not immediately from our point of view. But I suppose I'm just trying to give the concept of where that information's coming from. That's the reason I did the earlier talk about semantic data and things like that, semantic web. Okay. I apologise, I realise it was a very hard topic and there's a lot of information in there.
Thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much. So everyone,
okay. After the program's done overnight, I would look at it in my local drive. I put everything that downloaded to my local drive so that I can look at it when I come in every morning to see whether it's there. Make sure the download manager has downloaded the program. If it is not, I might have to do it online, or I mean during the day, or I have to resubmit it and they have to do it again that night. After the after all the programs has been downloaded, every program I have to click on it. I mean, I have to run through it from beginning to end, see whether it is properly downloaded. Sometimes when I look at some of the programs, they might be stopped in the middle and doesn't continue, so I have to re-download it again. But most of the time it's okay, it's from beginning to end. So when I finish looking at it, I will look at the classification of that program, and I will put the program into the server, into our server, according to classification. So this is what our server looks like. It's very simple, with few folders of classification, range from G, M, P, G, and MA, 15 plus. So all the programs will be under these folders. So because year 7 and year 8 is only allowed to watch programs from classification G and PG, so they are restricted to watch from those two folders, and all folders can be watched by students from grade 8 or above. Okay. The last thing I'll do is go into the V-Library. The V-Library is a simple catalog record, cataloging system generated by the VTV. For each of the programs I put into the server, they will generate a very simple record for me, so I can edit it and put in more information. So this is how the initial screen of the V-libraries look like. It's a very simple cataloging system. If I put in a program that I download, like the Meet the Romans, it will come up like this. It will come up in the list, so I can go into the program and have a look at the catalog record. Okay, if I go in the record, it is basically not like this, but because this is the record that I already upload the skills record and put in the subject heading, the copyright things on it. And if I need to edit a record, I will go into the edit function, and the edit function will take me to a screen like that, this. So all the details in this screen, I can go in and put in for subjects, I can put in more subjects. For copyright things, I can put the copyrights into the notes, and so on. And usually when I go in, I will change the collation of that record from MPEG to MP4, because all the records are downloaded as MP4 instead of MPEG. So this is usually is the things I've done for the record. And if the teacher needs to look at the program, they will go into the V-Library and they search for it, and then they would come up with the record, and they would double click on it, would take them to this record, and this is the other part of the record, because it's a very long record, so I have to put it into two screens. So this is the other part of the record. Usually we use plugins to view that record. Like we can use the QuickTime or we can use the VLC plugin to view the record. And they can just double click on the URL so then they can go into another screen to view the whole program, or they can download it from there. So it is a very simple video database management system, but it's not as efficient like as in ClickView or any other digital management system. But it's good for the school to use it to for the teachers to just get into one of the V library, and then they can just bring up the program and just view it. Okay.
I've got a bucket of questions. I might have missed when I first walked in the door. What's VTV? Who is that?
VTV is a product from Functional Solution. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
does it cost?
Yes, it costs a fair bit of money.
Is it software?
It is a software.
As well? Do they provide the server?
They don't provide the server. So we ourselves have to provide the server for ourselves. I think I need to talk to the IT people to get back to you.
What was your step to going to VTV? You obviously didn't have ClickView.
Because our principal doesn't want ClickView.
Oh, but have you had ClickView?
No.
No, we don't.
Oh, okay. So were you doing DVDs before this?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Much cheaper than ClickView. Do you know the price comparison?
I think it's the subscription is around a bit over $1,000 every year.
They watch it.
It's quite labor intensive.
So they're looking at a server at school. What happens at home? Can they watch it at home?
Well, if they have remote access to the V library, because V library you have a URL to link to it. So the V library is a catalog. Is that video catalog system so that you can go into V library, bring up the record, and then you can
do
it from there.
Yep. So they've opened a port for you to have a look at.
Yeah, and if they have the VLC plugin, QuickTime, but they don't have the iPad, so you can't stream it on the iPad.
Okay, so you can't see.
No. Okay. Yep. For right now, but
that was
maybe.
My bucket of questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
That was great. It's good to see the opportunity to do
it. Yeah.
Consider all cost conscious.
All right. Mine's not going to take very long because one day I thought to myself, okay, I know we've got, you know, some of us have lots of iPads, some of us don't have many iPads, some have iPads in the classrooms and we don't have them in the library. What about if we only had, say, one iPad in the library or just a couple of iPads, what could we do with an iPad? So I just went around and brainstormed, and I had Bernie's help and Katie's help where I take work placement to get some photos. So, okay, so I said, okay, iPad is catalog. So you can wander around with the iPad searching the catalog. So that was one. Roaming librarian, I like this one. I was out there, that's Graham. Working on site, we were out there looking at that tree and trying to figure out what it was. So we had the internet on the iPad, we're roaming around. So I think we could all be roaming librarians. Digital photo frame, we've all got great photos of things. So even if you've only got that one iPad, you know, why not actually have a digital photo frame and all the photos just, you know, rotating on a screen somewhere. So it's another way. The QR codes. So, you know, use those QR codes, because if you've got one iPad, then or you've got more in your library, then, you know, you can actually have lots of things with QR codes and get the students to interact with those. The virtual library. So we've got these apps on the iPad that you can actually create your own augmented reality. So you see that one there. Basically, when we put an iPad that we've built our augmented reality on against one of those blinds, it comes up with a little video that explains about the services that we have. So why don't we as libraries start doing that? You know, when I was at Queensland, what they did is they actually had, so people knew, and you'll notice, see those little signs, those little A's? Mm-hmm. That means if you have the correct iPad, that's the one to scan, because that's the sign. But in a primary school setting, what they had was little footprints, and they had their iPads colour-coded. So purple iPad was, it said purple feet. So you went there, the kids grabbed the purple iPad, scanned whatever it was, and it was actually the students talking about some work that they'd done. So there's options there. What about getting, you know, a subscription to newspapers online and having the digital subscription on your iPad? Who has the Sydney Morning Herald on their iPad, this subscription?
Oh, no. Someone gave it to me for free.
We've just secured, as of this morning, new touch screens, about so big, and we're putting it on the touch screen for them.
Yeah, see, that would work great.
Nice, man.
Excellent. Access your e-books. So, you know, start telling people, I have an iPad there, and actually go, look, you know, did you know that you can access your e-books and this is how you do it? Okay? And then the Apple TV, and unfortunately we're not using it today because of all the things that we had to change around, but basically, you know, start showing people that, you know, buy this little box, which the Apple TV box, which costs about $100, buy that and start implementing it in your library so you're modelling it and showing people how you could be walking around talking to the kids about things and doing things on the iPad, and those kids could be in one group here or over here. You don't have to be at the front like this. So it'd be good for us, I think, to be modelling that. So they were my eight ideas, so nine. So that was Bernie and I sitting only a few metres apart, conferencing via FaceTime. But, you know, why don't we use this more? Like, we could be using it
especially
ourselves.
With the rollout of the operating system, the 6 point, the one before, the one we've just got, it makes FaceTime not lag on your network. It's like, it's
oh, okay.
And so it's had a big effect in schools if you're using it, especially in, we use it to harass our IT boys when they feel like answering it, because it means you can find them everywhere, but it's no longer streaming.
Yeah. I mean, why don't we have, you know, a FaceTime ID as the library person, and you say to people and staff, if you've got iPads, send me a message on FaceTime and I'll answer your research query, or I'll tell you what books you need, you know. I mean, there's options, you know. I know it's a, there's always different options that we could be thinking about. And then document camera. You probably can't see that very clearly, but you've all probably seen that stand that we've got in the library, the iPad stand. Basically, we put the stand and put the iPad horizontal and then put the camera on. And so we could actually have the book here. So if you're thinking about big books, or if you're trying to show a book to a range of students and you only have one iPad, you could actually put the iPad over the top of it, flick through the book, and you can be showing the whole class.
It also means you don't breach copyright by making another format copy of the book, so if you showed it, you're not...
That's exactly right.
Yep.
And that, I mean, that's a stand that we bought, but there are other stands out and about around there, so, and I'm sure people could come up with quite sort of imaginative ideas to make their own as well. Okay, so there's the stand there, and that's how easy it was. So that was my 10 ways with iPads.
Okay, hi everyone, my name's Benita Sneesby. I've met a lot of you, some of you I haven't. I work Monday, Tuesday, Thursdays at Parramatta Marist High, and Wednesdays and Thursdays at Holy Family Luddenham Primary. Okay, what I'd like to present to you today is a little bit of innovation that we created at Marist. To start off with, we had a prac teacher in who was really tech savvy, or wanted to be tech savvy with the Year 7 students. And as you know, Marist is boys, so to get them interactive with reading, their chosen text, which was Chronicles of Narnia, Lion, Witch and Wardrobe, they had to do a book review. So we had the option of just handing them a sheet with questions that they had to answer, write it down, we go through, we edit, and go through that way, give them feedback. Instead, we decided to create what we call our queue review. And I actually brainstormed with the prac teacher because Brother Patrick, because we're going one-to-one iPad with Year 7s, he wanted technology used, and we thought, well, what better way? We're already using QR codes at the school, so let's create something. So I'm going to hold up to you, the wrong one. This is the this is what we call our queue review. It's very interactive. We made several of them, about eight of them. We had eight tables, and we put one on each table for the boys. Straight away, hands on. Wow, what's that? Then they heard noise. Actually, in the queue review, we actually have as a reward, and it actually gets them to focus and actually go through the questions and really think about their answers, but they get jelly beans at the end of it. Okay, the jelly beans are actually in the 6 thinking hat colours as well. We're active in teaching our Year 7s about De Bono's 6 thinking hats and what each colour represents. So what we did, we strategically numbered the queue review, coloured it and numbered it to each of the questions. So Vivian and I went through, and so for instance, the first one is the white hat, which is fact and objective, and that was pretty much looking at the genre and the book title and the author. Number 2 was the blue hat, because they had to have a process and they had to have an overview of the book in their own words and come up with some decisions on why they would have chosen, say, music to that book. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually scan one and just show you the process. So if we go, I'll go, say, number 3. So we scan it using QRafter Pro. A new note, and they'd paste it. Okay, then they had an opportunity to actually write down what they thought. With number 1, it does have their name and their class and their teacher. So we have a document then, after all the questions are scanned, we actually have their book review. Then what we do is we upload it via the Dropbox, and then we go through, edit the child's work, give them feedback, and then going forward, what we're going to do is the 3 best book reviews after we've edited, because we have our own LibraryThing account, we upload it to LibraryThing through Parramatta Marist. Okay, so that's the book review. I can talk to anyone further about all this and how we created it going forward. But what I'd like to share with you as well is we actually had a professional development day with all staff, and we had to use a form of technology. Like I said, we're very big on QR codes at the moment. We're actually putting QR codes on all our genre, our literature circles, using Bridge URL, which is a website where you can actually attach as many as you like, and the QR code will never change by attaching all these different websites. So we needed to get out to the staff what we're about. We're not just about checking in books and checking out books, which most of the staff pretty much think that we are, even as technicians. So we had a lot to offer. Everything is linked to our blog, and so we wanted to showcase that. So what we did is we created new QR cubes. Okay, this time we put this time we put Minties in for the staff. And we kind of, again, went around the 6 thinking hat colours, but it isn't actually attached to any hat as such. It was just like a really colourful cube, so we used the colours again. And how we identify the difference is because number 6, the last one that we showcase, is the black and white, and the book review's number 1. So that's how we identify it. Oh, and what's inside. So, pretty much, so what we did was, if we go back to QRafter Pro.
Why do you use that rather than the free QRafter?
Because we can read and create.
Okay.
It scans and creates, so it's paid. And I find it the most like the best one for the kids for the notes as well, like for the book review, that's our chosen one. But if I want to do a funky design, like these are actually created by QRT, which is QR code art in iTunes. Oh yeah, down there, QRT. Yeah, so you can see I use a lot of generators and readers for different projects that we use. So for instance, let's see, I don't even know which one goes to what here, but I would guess that number one goes straight to our PMH library blog. Yeah, it does. So through our actual Learning Centre blog, which every resource that the teacher needs now for research, they come through the blog. So, and with Pinterest, everything's through Pinterest, and that is what the rest of these codes are, like explaining our research toolkit for teachers, our research toolkit for students, a day in the life of the Learning Centre. One of them, this one's Creative Commons. One of them's Literature Circles. So what we did is whatever we're working on, and this can be changed at any time, we're showcasing who we are. Okay.
Is that a paid blog as well?
Oh, Pinterest. No, it's free. It's free and you can create as many boards as you want. For instance, I'll show you the research, teachers research toolkit. This is everything that we think that teachers need to be aware of in order for best practice of teaching the boys at Marist, what we found that they could offer the students. So right down to click view, if you click on this, please work, if you click on this, it should take us straight to our click view login screen. It does, for instance. So everything that is back there, and this is all iPad happy as well. Everything works on the iPad. So if we go back and just say another board, Creative Commons. You know, if the teachers want to know about Creative Commons, just click on it on the picture and it'll take you straight to Creative Commons website. Or here, why Creative Commons.
So no questions.
Excellent.
We've got another minute or two.
Yeah. Okay. But pretty much Pinterest, yeah. Sign up. That's really good. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Sign out now. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. I think it's important that those two things, you know, we're here for the students, but we also need to be telling our staff what we do.
Absolutely.
Oh, and these remain up in their staff room as well. So if they've got an iPhone, the teachers, they just go through and they just go, oh, I wonder what that is.
It's a yum cha.
Yum cha.
Looking at it. It's
clever.
That
very clever idea. Love it. Thank you, Denise.
On the test, yes.
Right. My name is Ludi Bothma. For those of you who don't know me, I'm at Terra Sancta College. And I just want to share with you what we have done to try and get our readers, get more students to read. Because every time when it's NAP plan results, then the teachers come and they say, what can we do to get our students to read more? And every time that they say, our students must read more, then I think, it's my department, that one. What shall I do? And what can one do to try and get students to read more? Because you don't, you just see students when they get into the library, they walk around there and they're out. So what else can I do to get them to read more? And we came up with I've heard the idea and we've implemented that, is to start with a reader's cafe. So every second Friday, we turn the whole library into a cafe. We put up things on the table, flowers and whatever. We put something for them to drink and to eat. And we call it the Reader's Cafe, and they love it. the idea behind it is not for students to come into the library and sit quietly in a corner and read. That is not what we plan or what we wanted to do with the Reader's Cafe. We wanted to make it something fashionable. Reading must be fashionable for them. So we thought of how can we make it fashionable? How can we make it interactive? How can we make it give a little bit of glamour to it? And in trying to do that, we decided, all right, we will start off giving the students that are really good readers, that we can see that are readers, we will give them invitations to come to the library for Reader's Cafe. So it's not everybody that can come to the Reader's Cafe. It must be somebody that are really a reader. So they get a personal invitation and they can attend the Reader's Cafe. So that is something that the students that we find, a lot of them want to be part of the Reader's Cafe. They want to be also there where they, what are they doing there? So it's an incentive to start reading, because to get into the Reader's Cafe, you have to be a reader. So we start off with the Reader's Cafe. I just want to show you a few photos. What we do with Reader's Cafe, except for the fact that they come in to come and read and have time to drink something, is I don't buy books anymore by just going out to a car and go and collect books there or whatever. If booksellers want to sell books to us, they have to come and display the books during Reader's Cafe, and the students pick the books. They decide, especially the fiction, what books they want to read, and they just love it. And I find that when they're in there and they pick the books, they also take ownership of the collection of the library. And I've walked between them and I listen to what they say, and they would say, "Ah, we have this book already," or "Ah, here's the new one of this series." And they know what's in the library, and that really makes them read whatever we buy, because they know, because they've picked the books to read. Now that is all in the cafe, and as you can see, it's not a quiet cafe. It is really where they can discuss books, and I find that they also, there's a little bit of snobbishness about it, because they can say, "Huh, you haven't read that." So if they can feel that they are the first one to discover the books of zombies or whatever, they're the first one to read it, and they can share it with the rest of the students, and they do it in Reader's Cafe, it's really something that motivates them to read. But then a spin-off of that, oh, sorry. The spin-off of that was when we created a readers club. So when they read all these books and all these new books, I want them to tell the rest of the school and all the other students what is these books about, and they have to blog on it. And when they blog on it, I find that they write. That's part of it. And the more they write, the other spin of it, the more you read, the more you like to write as well. And if you write about books, you can also end up writing stories. So it's all things that we thought might be good for lifting up the literacy in our school. So this is my little blog that I have, and as you can see, the students are quite active on it. Something else that comes from it, if they are reading, it stimulates their writing. So a lot of them, what I do with them, I want them to write. And when they write, I send this off to play things like Spineout and Unleash is another magazine, and try and get it published. So if they write something and they get it published, it makes them feel proud. And it just makes them read more. And I can say that, for instance, since last year, if we look at our the books that were loaned out, is much more now than it was last year. And I think this has a lot to do with it, is the fact that they took ownership of the books, of buying of the books. They know what is there, and they know that they can get it in the library, and they like to show the others what they read. So this is just something that I thought I'd share with you, how we created an atmosphere of being proud to read and making it something that they like to belong to it and the school. And Reader's Cafe is something that everybody's talking about in the school, so this is something that they do. It's an activity that they do.
Do you have lunch,
Ludi?
Every second Friday.
Lunch.
At lunch, so you close the library to everything else.
Yeah.
Reader's Cafe.
Everybody else, they cannot come into the library because this is just for the readers. Okay. And it makes it special, and it makes it for them something that... It's about... they're not forced to come, but they get invitations, and it's only on invitation basis. It's about 50 students.
So many per year?
No. No, I give it to readers. And if they want to become part of that, they have to be, to show me that they read. They have to, and I want really to, and also English teachers can tell me, they also can give out invitations. What is very good is that they write. I just want to show you. For instance,
say some of your readers were in your Write a Book in a Day team?
Yes, they are very much the Write in a Book in a Day students. So I think, you know, that is the kind of students that are taking part in this, and that is the students that read more, and that's the students that write more. For instance, this student, this is something that I've sent off to to be published in Unleash. This student had a conversation with this author, and she put it on the blog, under my interviews, and I've sent this off to be published. And I try and publish these short stories, because a lot of them are writing short stories in the club. And if the short story is finished, I send it off to Unleash or to Spineout or one of these places to be published. And students just love it if they can see that something of what they've done is published.
You'll just write to the blog directly?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm trying to tell them that they have to be, make sure that everything is okay. I do think it's okay. Up to now.
Get approval first before it's published? Set it up like that?
What? To Spineout?
Yes, no, the blog. See, I wouldn't give my kids access to our blog. They would come to us and we write on it.
I've started this in 2000 and... let me see, when was it? I think it was 2010.
And so they write direct to the blog?
Yes, but I'm there when they write it, and I'm checking it all the time. But I've never had a problem up to now, because I do give it to students that are really readers and that I can see that are responsible. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Any other questions for Ludi?
Ludi, you said that circulation has increased.
Yes. You know what? I've looked at the circulation. Last year, November, the books that we borrowed to students was 200. This year it's 480.
Okay.
for October.
So that's so, but you think that's across the board, the other kids pick up and maybe we get the Reader's Cafe as well?
I think some of them read to come to become part of the Reader's Cafe, but I've also done a few other things. We've bought a whole lot of magazines. I bought almost $1,500 worth of magazines a year. And a lot of students are attracted to the library to come and read the magazines. And they're not in the readers area where they read magazines. They're not allowed to do anything else there except for reading. And we do that, and I put a lot of books that I think that might interest them. I put it on a shelf into that readers area, which is popular reading books. And they've been reading more non-fiction as well because of that. But I've put books like UFOs and that kind of stuff in there for them to read so that they can see it more. But I think they do read more, yes. Especially because they know that they can get all these books that the latest. We try and keep up with them because we do these displays. We can see what they really go for, you know, when they want us to buy the books. So we can see what they go for, and we're trying to keep that up. Give them the chance to decide what they want to read and what they want the library to buy. That makes a big difference.
Okay.